Debbie. So I see there's a few folks with us today that have not been here in the past, and I should tell you that we're kind of in the middle of a series. The series is called Your Impact on the World. And basically what we're doing is we're going at a turtle's pace. We're going very, very slow to help you to understand how you can have an impact on the world in your life, in your Christian life. And each week we're taking a new word. And if you've been here from the beginning, you remember that we've covered, including today, three words. And those words were transformation, proclamation, and today's dedication. All of these words are designed specifically to bring you closer to having a distinct impact on the world, to having a distinct impact on yourselves, and indeed, to have a distinct impact on each other. However, no project, and I want to explain that word project to you if I can. It's in the way I preach. I preach in series of things that I see in the world. I don't know if it's still a lot of series or not. But anyway, there's a joke that went around for a very long time. And then it just got turned into a story, so I'm just going to kind of tell it to you the way I remember it. The story was that a man went up to the preacher and he said to him, "I've been going to church for 50 years, and I'll be doggone, but I just do not remember even 2 weeks ago what your sermon was about." Now, I don't know if this was a cut down and let this guy's sermons that he doesn't remember, or they're bad, or they're whatever. It really doesn't matter. Because the preacher looked at him and he said, "Well, what is it that you had for breakfast 2 weeks ago Monday?" And the guy said, "Well, I don't know." And he said, "Well, what is it that you had for lunch 2 weeks ago Tuesday?" And the guy said, "I don't know." And he said, "What was it that you had for supper 2 weeks ago Wednesday?" And the guy said, "Well, I don't know." He says, "You don't remember those meals that you had, but I guarantee you, those meals contributed to making the man standing in front of me asking me this question. Because they nourished you. They made you stronger. If you ate health happy or a health heart healthy, I can't even say the word. Then you're standing here with a healthy heart in front of me. If you indulged in sugar, maybe you're standing here a couple pounds heavier than you were 2 weeks ago. The point is, you don't remember those meals, but they touched you, they moved you, they made you better, or they made you worse. They contributed to who you are." And that's exactly the way sermons are. You've been going to sermons for 50 years, and I guarantee you, you don't have to remember what each one is. It's changed you. It's moved you. It's made you the man that you are today. And that's all the job of God. God says, "Come in the door, and I'll take care of the rest." So, I need you to understand, that is the way many preachers preach. They preach out of this thing they call an lectionary. An lectionary, what it does is it gives you a sample of New Testament verse, sample Old Testament verse, and maybe a few more thrown in there. And you as a preacher, you read those four or five verses, and you decide which one you want to preach on that particular Sunday. And that is how they preach, Sunday after Sunday after Sunday. There is no relationship between from one Sunday to the next Sunday. So, if you're going to get something out of this Sunday, you better get something out of this Sunday's message and take it home with you, because you're not going to hear it again. And next week's is not going to relate to it. In so much as the Bible, everything in the Bible relates to each other. But other than that, and that's a perfectly fine way to teach. That's the way these guys who have been teaching to this man for 50 years have taught. It's the overall that has changed who he is. But that's also the reason that I do things a little bit differently, and I follow that sect that teaches in series. Because I call a series a project. Usually it's 4, 5, 6 weeks long. You'll know the last series we did with that event. And the purpose of a series is to get, not only to get you to change, but to change more immediately. It's to get you involved in making a change in yourself more immediately, instead of waiting for that progression, that overall progression of God's growing you spiritually very slowly. I ask you to get involved. I ask you to be a part of your journey by going over, it's called repetition, that's how we make new habits, by going over the same thing over and over again for 4, 5, or 6 weeks. Because it sticks in your mind then. In your 6 days out of here, you start remembering, oh yeah, we're working on this, I'm supposed to be doing this. So that's why I teach in series. And I want you to be a part of that. But no project, like I said, I call these things projects, no project, no matter how good or bad it is even possible without this word, dedication, on the part of its participants. Basically, all that means is that you have decided that you will wrap your mind around this particular series, and you decided to participate in it. If you do that, I guarantee you'll change the person who sits here before me today. I guarantee that. And I guarantee it'll be for the good. And you might say, well, I think I'm a pretty good Christian the way I am now. And I agree with you 100%. You probably are. You're probably a better Christian than I am. But the fact of the matter is, none of us are that good that we can't stand to improve. That's what God wants out of us, constant improvement. So essentially, if you decide to participate, what you have to do, we have to bring in that repetition, we have to bring our minds into a state in which we can often remember what it is we're participating in. Because so much that we do day in and day out, we do what I call mindless activities. Mindless activities include things like the alarm goes off, we get out of bed. We go in there and we brush our teeth in the morning. So for some of us, our mindless activity in the morning is to take a shower. For some of us, our mindless activity is to eat breakfast. And then we get in the car, and it's a mindless activity to put it in drive or reverse. We just know it's automatic. Everything that we do, we have done for so long, it's automatic. It's a response. It's that we don't even think about it. So the question is, where is our mind when we're doing these mindless activities? And I guarantee it's been all over the place. I guarantee your mind will go from one thought to another in New York City. It is fast. You can't even catch it sometimes. You're all over the place. But if you remember, take this time during those that part of the day when you go through most of your mindless activities, if you take control of those mindless activities and say, hey, we're working on a project. As soon as I get up tomorrow morning, I'm going to start thinking about that project because that's the best time of the day for me to be thinking about it. That's the best time of the day for me to remember it before I leave the house and go out into the world and go out into work or do all that is demanded of me throughout the day. First thing in the morning, I'm going to try to bring that stuff into play. And then the next thing you know, you're brushing your teeth with love. I know that sounds silly, but you'll even put a smile on your face while you're brushing your teeth. It sounds silly, but I guarantee you it will change the person that you are. That's why we're going slow with this, because I want you to change who you are to be a better person. That person that we're trying to emulate in this series is St. Mother Teresa. You know that. But in the morning is the very best time to capture those, that thing that we're doing, that project. So now let's look over at what we've been doing for the last couple of weeks. Basically, it's pretty simple. I have not asked you to do very much. The first week, it was pretty simple. All I asked you to do was to be like me. And like me is, that's me. Get excited about coming to church on Sunday morning. Get excited about that 1 hour that you get to spend with each other, with your extended family. Why is that excitement so important? Well, it's only natural that it's going to be important because you come in here for that hour to be lifted up, to be supported, to be listened to be helped, to be held up, to be carried, to be loved. Who in the world, if this was a commodity in the pagan market, it would sell like hotcakes. Who wouldn't want that in their lives, at least now a week? Who wouldn't want to come to a place where you could be lifted up and supported and listened to and helped? And held up and carried and loved. Good heavens. That's what human beings crave. So who wouldn't get excited about that? So get excited like that little girl. Be excited like me. Because I get to spend this next hour with you. Even more than an hour since it's a carry. I get to spend it with you. And I'm going to depend on some of you to lift me up, to carry me, to hold me. And most importantly, to love me, as I will do for you, as we will do for each other. That's what church is. That's what family is. Second thing I ask you to do, in the second week, I didn't ask you to change a single thing that you're doing in your normal routine. I did not ask you to change anything. I only asked you to tweak it. I only asked you to tweak each and every little thing that you did during the day with love and a smile. Those two are crucial. Those two, I talked about Mother Teresa, that was the way she lived her entire life. It didn't make any difference what she was doing. At any given time, she threw her heart and her love into whatever it was. I don't care if it was turning that page. She threw her heart and her love into it. And she smiled. You walk up and meet Mother Teresa, she put a smile on her face that made you feel like you were the most important person in her whole wide world today. For this next 10 seconds that you're going to have an interaction with her. You are the most important person. And that's our ambition, to get like that. So that people recognize us. So that people recognize how we live. So that people recognize our joy. And then we can be examples of evangelism. But that got to be a little bit more difficult for you. Got to be a little bit more difficult because of just what I said. You forgot. You forgot a lot. And that's okay. Because sometimes it takes a very long time to start a new habit in your life. Sometimes a very long time. It is entirely up to you how fast you want to build up. Because you have to control this up here. And I gave you a couple of little techniques. Techniques like post-it notes. Put post-it notes on your refrigerator. Love/smile. Put post-it note in your office or on the bathroom toilet paper. I don't care where you put it. Put it on there. Take a little 3x5 card and write love/smile. Not smiley face. Put it in the pocket that you normally reach into during the day. Take a little piece of two-sided tape and put it in the center of your steering wheel. Make yourself little notes. There's lots of ways that you can bring to the forefront of your mind this project, the project that you're working on here in this church. And in time, you will get there. You will get there. And all these other things that you do in order to get there, they're all extensions of what we call dedication. They're all important. Dedication to God, dedication to yourselves, dedication to each other, dedication to this project. In fact, dedication to your making an impact on the world. So today I'm going to add a little project to what we're doing. I'm going to be hard first week, get excited about coming. Second week, add love and a smile to everything that you do, doesn't make any difference what it is. Now I'm going to give you examples of what to do. I told you before, I would do all the heavy lifting in this series. All you need to do is go out and do it. But I'll tell you exactly what to do. And that's exactly what I've done in this particular case. What we're going to do is add to this project a list of acts of kindness. Now it's going to be different than the normal acts of kindness that we normally are associated with. But I could have easily made a slide and put up there additional three words, act of kindness. But as in my research, I happened to find this sign, and I thought it was so spot on, I had to use it. It says the smallest act of kindness is worth more than the grandest intention. And that is just ever so, so very true. But anyway, I told you I did all this, and had to listen for you. So I made this little sheet right here, a little act of kindness sheet. And I purposely made this difficult to fold up and put in your pocket. Even more difficult to fit in the garbage can. You're going to have to actually take this and purposely put it someplace because this thing is so heavy. But I had on here a whole bunch of acts of kindness. Now, some of them came from me. Some of them came from y'all. Some of them came from the internet. I had multiple places where I came up with this list. But here's how it works. It's really very simple. You should take the list. Everybody's going to get one when they leave here today. Take the list and look over the list. Read all of them. I want you to pray over the list. If you want to, I want you to meditate over the list. I want you to continue going over the list until something jumps out off that piece of paper. Something jumps out and touches your heart. And then I want you to add that to your day-to-day routine. That act of kindness, I want you to add to your day-to-day routine. Now there's a bunch of stuff on here that you can't add to your day-to-day routine. Like for instance, for a long time several years ago, we did an act of kindness sermon, and we made these little cards, and it says, "Your will was paid for by Jesus. Have a great day," or something along those lines. And I gave everybody one or two or three. And the reports afterward, everybody just absolutely loved doing that. They loved watching the other families. It was all anonymous, but they loved watching the families whose meal they just paid for and had received one of these cards. The problem with it was, after you got rid of your one, two, or three cards, however it was that I handed out, the whole act of kindness thing died. And maybe it continued for some of you in this room. I don't know. You haven't told me that it has continued. Certainly in the men's group, it has continued. Every month, we pay for a meal that is some family that's in the other room, the waitress is in this mouth. But the whole idea here is that it doesn't die. The whole idea here is that your act of kindness continues day in and day out and becomes a habit. Becomes a part of who you are. Now, for that to happen, you have to pick something that you can do every day. Let's say that you want to continue with the meal thing. But you know you're not that affluent. You can't go out every day and buy a meal for somebody at another table. The other reason is not many of us eat out every day. So we can do that once a week or once a month or however often you want to. But we'll take something else off the list that we can do every day. Number 25, I love number 25, it's a smile at everybody you see. It will get you in that habit. It's contagious. It will change the person that you are. I guarantee it. Okay, so as you're going through this list, there's only three rules, and you probably already know before I put them up here what they are. Number one is, do your act of kindness for somebody else or a group. This is not pre-gender. Do it for somebody else or a group. Every single day, pick something on this list. Rule number two is add the element of luck to your act of kindness. Just like you might be used to it by now. You might have spent this last week practicing. You might have gone through this last week adding love to the things that you do, the little things. Add great love to those. And of course, number three, rule three is add the element of a smile to your act of kindness. Even if it's anonymous and you don't want the other person to see it, you smile at it. Because you're smiling at it trains the muscles in your face to do something that it's not used to doing. And then when it's important that you do that thing, when you have confrontation or encounters, is a better word, when you have encounters with other people, that's when you want that smile to come out. So if you practice beforehand, hey, you're in good shape. So, now there's something that I wanted to add on this part, to tell you about this list, because you're not going to be with me when you get it. At the very back of it, there's a little section back there that's called your wall. Now, I added these things, but these things are kind of the more extreme things. These are the things that most of us might not be able to do, but some of us can do. But they're there for you to look at. They're not the type of thing that you certainly would be doing every day, but they are important in as acts of kindness for you to get in that habit. You can afford it, do it. One of the things on the back of that list there is the very first one is Sponsor a Child with Compassion International. This will cost you about $45 a month. If you can afford to do that, great. If you can't afford it, don't worry about it. Some of you think, there's no way I can afford to do that. I can guarantee you that there is a way that you can afford that because I did. 10 years ago, Nancy and I were at a Michael W. Smith concert. And right outside after the concert was over in foyer, he always had these tables where, from Compassion, where they try to get you to sponsor a child. Well, I signed up 10 years ago and we sponsored a child, and I arranged it so that this money comes directly out of my checking account every single month. And all I have to do is remember to make an entry in my ledger. If I had to write a check, it would have been the first budget cut to come along, I guarantee you. If I had to pay in some other way, I would have recognized it. Too much so that it would have been a budget cut. But I guarantee this way, we've been doing it now for 10 years, a little bit. We sponsored for 3, it's kind of responsive, and now I'm over 13 years old. And guess what? He is my drop in the ocean. He is my drop on the other side of the world. He will one day, the Compassion, the way they set it up is, they go into a big village or a big city or something like that, and they'll see that there's a whole bunch of kids in that village. So what they'll do is they'll build a school and a church, and they will build a rec yard. And then they'll try to get sponsors for all these different children in this area. If they get sponsored, they get to go to the school. They not only get an education, they get a Christian education. My little guy has been going to the school for 10 years now, or 8 years, however, he might have to go to his father. But whatever the case might be, he's going to be my drop in a bucket. He's going to be my drop in the ocean. He's going to be my hands and feet in Africa one day. I know that because that's my prayer to God, that he uses him. No matter what that little boy does when he grows older, no matter who he affects, no matter what evangelism he does, it will come back to me because I gave him that basis. I gave him that start. I gave him that education. And I didn't do nothing except make that little education and forget about it. Forget about it, except for the prayers that I send to the other side of the world. I guarantee you, you can change the world. There are churches who sponsor entire orphanages on the other side of third world countries. I guarantee you, they're changing the world in a big way, and that's fine. They don't have to change the world in a big way. They can do it. I can only change the world in a little way. One little guy over in Africa. So by golly, I'll smile. But that's the way voters are supposed to vote, all that stuff. Follow this program, you will change the world. Amen. All right, if you would now, turn in your bulletins for your operating meeting.